Okay, good morning. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me. I did some stuff that is related to algebraic computation, etc., but I think it's very safe to define me as an outsider to your area, but still, you are one of the groups that hopefully would appreciate the story that I want to tell. Especially those who haven't heard it already, or maybe those who already did hear it because I've been going around and giving versions and versions of this talk for quite some time. Anyway, let's go. So we are talking about, combinatorial and computational geometry, mostly combinatorial, and this area was essentially, to a large extent, founded by, is the sound okay? Because, owes its origin to Paul Erdős, I'm sure I don't need to introduce him, who really laid down the foundations of many subtopics in the area, and on the occasion of his 80th birthday, he wrote this thing: "My most striking contribution to geometry is no doubt my problem on the number of distinct distances. This can be found in many of my papers, etc." So he posed that problem and the related problem on repeated distances in a paper on the American Mathematical Monthly in 1946, and those problems really caught many people, and there was practically no progress until very recently. So the problems are as follows. The distinct distance problem, you are given a set of endpoints in the plane, and you want to establish a lower bound on the number of distinct distances between those points, no matter how the set looks like. So kind of a universal lower bound. The repeated distance, in contrast, you are again given endpoints in the plane and some distance, say one, and you want to get an upper bound on the number of pairs of the points that lie at distance exactly one from each other. Both are extremely difficult questions, but I will concentrate or I'll mention more the first one. So obviously, if the set of points is in general position, you will get entries to distinct distances, so the points are allegedly kind of highly structured in highly degenerate situation, a lattice-like or whatever, like the construction you see there. Now, Erdős has noticed that if you look at the square root n by square root n integer lattice, and using some number theoretical results, you only have of the order of n over square root log n distinct distances. And he conjectured that this is indeed the answer. So every point of endpoints in the plane must have at least n, some constant n over root log n distinct distances. And that problem turned out to be a real, one of the very hardest nuts in the area. And before this revolution that I'm alluding to, the best that people could come up was a lower bound of the form n to the, as you can see on the slides. And that, even that took a lot of effort. Now, Erdős, of course, is the main founding father, but another Hungarian, George Elekes, was the driving force behind the emergence of this new technology and results and techniques and whatever. Unfortunately, he died rather prematurely in 2008, just before the revolution broke in, so to speak, out of heavy smoking, which is probably one of the morals for my talk, please do not smoke. But I mean, even with this heavy smoking, he did a lot, as you will see. So sometime earlier, he was thinking about the distinct distances problem and had an idea, had a program or plan or whatever. And he managed to, I'll say a few things about it soon, to reduce this problem to an incidence problem between points and what turned out eventually to be lines in three dimensions. And the reduction led him to several conjectures that if he could prove them, he would get almost the bound that Erdős conjectured. He would get the bound n over log n. So one factor of square root log n still missing, but that would still be an amazing result. But he couldn't prove his conjectures. Nobody else could, and he passed away. And just three months later, the first breakthrough took place in a paper by Larry Guth and Netz, Hawk, Katz, with a strange title, as you can see. And they established, they solved another open, difficult, not as difficult as distinct distances problem about the number of joints in a set of n lines in three dimensions. A joint, so you are given a set of n lines in three dimensions, and a joint is a point that is incident to at least three non-coplanar lines. So for example, if you look at the grid construction here, and you choose about root n by root n by root n points, then you have about n vertical lines parallel to the coordinate directions that go through them, and every point is a joint. So you have roughly n lines, and n to the 3 half, excuse me, joints, and the conjecture was that this is indeed an upper bound. So no matter how, what n lines I give you, in three dimensions, you will have at most n to the 3 half joints. So Guth and Katz managed to solve this problem, borrowing ideas from Dvir that applied the same tricks to a Kakeya problem in finite fields, never mind, and had some other fairly simple tricks compared to what comes next, and they managed to solve the problem. We conjectured this bound around 1992. This is what I told you about the lattice. And at the end, once you simplify their proof, it becomes really trivial. And in the earlier versions of this talk, I actually gave the proof, but now there is no time, unfortunately. And in fact, you can extend it to any dimensions. In D dimensions, a joint would be a point, again, in a collection of lines that is incident to at least D lines that do not lie in a common hyperplane. And then the bound becomes n to the d over d minus 1. There were two papers that appeared more or less on the same day on archive and had more or less an identical proof. And the proof is really easy. So in terms of the historical story, after the first paper came up, I tried to apply to Elekesh conjectures, but couldn't. But I still kind of published it with very partial results, but Guth and Katz picked them up and used more advanced machinery and eventually managed to prove Elekesh conjectures and get the lower bound on the number of distinct distances n over log n, almost solving the problem except for this missing factor of square root log n. Okay. By the way, I say that we are in the 10th anniversary because their first paper on this Kakeya joints problem appeared in 2008. Okay, so what, just a few hints, what was Elekesh reduction? So he considered the space of all rigid motions in the plane, which we may call rotation because each one of them more or less is a rotation around some point. And each one of them has 3 degrees of freedom, so you can represent it as a point in 3 dimensions, 2 of translation and 1 of rotation. And the very trivial observation is that I give you 2 pairs of points, then there is a rotation that maps A to A prime and B to B prime, if and only if the distance AB is equal to the distance A prime B prime. That was the starting point. So Elekesh considered for a pair of points AA prime the locus of all rotations that take A to A prime. And with the right parameterization, it turns out to be a line in three dimensions. It has just 1 degree of freedom because after I map, what? After I map A to A prime, all I can do is just rotate the plane around that point. So there's 1 degree of freedom. With careful parameterization, I get it to be a line. So if you have two pairs at the same distance apart, the two corresponding lines must touch each other at the common rotation. And then using some very simple and very ingenious application of the considerable inequality, that's all there is to it, he got to his main conjecture, which says the following, that if I give you a bunch of lines in three dimensions, and I want to estimate the number of points, which are now rotations, that are incident to at least k of the lines. It means that you have a rotation in this parameterization, you have a rotation that maps at least k points of your set to k other points of the set. And then his conjecture was that in general, for an arbitrary collection of lines in space, the number should be the number of lines to the 3/2 divided by k squared. The 3/2 is the same 3/2 that you see in the joints problem, and it's not a coincidence. It's kind of an intrinsic exponent. Okay? So the interesting thing is those two problems have a lot in common. They are, in fact, questions about incidences between points and lines in three dimensions. Guth and Katz managed to solve both of them using algebraic, kind of sophisticated algebraic machinery. I'll mention a little bit about it later. And both are very hard problems, distinct distances extremely hard, joints fairly hard, that nobody could solve using quote-unquote conventional techniques. And the algebraic machinery, once it demonstrated its ability to solve these problems, has been applied time and again over the past decade for many other problems, as I'll try to mention. So since incidences is the hero behind this whole story, let me just spend a couple of slides on them. An incidence, technically, between a point and something, like say a line, is just the fact that the point lies on the line. The simplest question would be in the plane. You have m points and n lines, and you count the number of incidences between them. You can see, so every point counts the number of lines it lies on, and you want a bound for this total number. So if you have m points and n lines and look at the maximum possible number of incidences between them, then there is a very influential and basic paper by Semeredi and Trotter back from 1983, where they establish a tight, asymptotically tight, bound of m to the 2/3, n to the 2/3 plus m plus n. It's one of the very few bounds in incidence theory that is known to be tight in the worst case. In most instances, we know very little. Okay, a commercial, why do we care about incidences? So there are a lot of reasons. I mean, the fact that it even managed to find its way into this Kakeya problem, which doesn't seem to have much to do with incidences, it's just another manifestation. It arises in many applications. Oh. And points and lines in the plane, which is the simple instance, is really the simplest instance, and there are many other questions that you could ask. For example, incidences between points and circles, incidences between points and lines in three dimensions, in higher dimensions, with surfaces, with other curves. There is a whole zoo of things that you can ask, and many of them are quite difficult and interesting. So incidence geometry has become a popular topic because Guth and Katz managed to reduce Erdős distinct distance problem to an incidence question. But let me say right away that an Elekes conjectures in effect tried to get a better bound than the bound you would get from the Semeredi-Trotter planar case. I mean, if you are you have points and lines in three dimensions, it's actually a stupid question to ask for a new bound on incidences, because if it is in three dimensions, just project everything on the plane and you'll get a planar problem. And if you place points and lines in the plane and pretend that plane lies in three dimensions, you'll get the same bound. So there is you gain nothing by moving to three dimensions, unless you make the problem truly three-dimensional, but by not allowing too many lines or too many points to lie on a common plane. And that happens in the Elekesh reduction, and that's why we are able to get a better bound. So the whole thing brought into bear lots of techniques from algebraic geometry, differential geometry, algebraic topology. There are many areas that were enlisted, so to speak. The main thing I want to mention is this polynomial partitioning, which is one of the major contributions of Guth and Katz to this theory, but there is a lot of other stuff. The major ingredients that they use in their analysis come from works in the 19th century. As you can see, at that time, algebraic geometry was algebraic geometry before the algebraicists took over and turned it into an algebraic geometry. So at that time, people really did it geometrically, got a lot of results, many of them wrong. That's why the algebra people took over. But still, they were quite useful in this adventure. So Elekesh conjecture talks about, I give you lines and I ask how many points lie on at least k of them. But I can turn the thing around, as is common here, and ask it the other way around. I give you points and lines in three dimensions, and I want to get a bound on the number of incidences between them. And so although they didn't state it explicitly, this is what they did. They established this bound, which turned out to be better than the Semmered-Itrotter bound. And once you have it, you can get Elekesh conjecture by simply substituting mk as a lower bound for these quantities. If you look for m points each lying on at least k lines, then this is at least mk. And when you solve this inequality for m, you get exactly what Elekesh conjectured. Okay, so polynomial partitioning, the main technique. This is in itself a major thing. What is polynomial partitioning? It is the following result. You have n points in d dimensions, and I give you some degree d, or some parameter t, and I want to partition the points into subsets, each of size roughly n over t, roughly t such subsets, and I can do it by a polynomial. So I can find a polynomial whose degree is the dth root of t, of this parameter t, that if I look at its zero set and the complement of the zero set, and the complement of the zero set is a collection of connected components, then each of these connected components will contain at most n over t points. The number of components is roughly t, because if you have a polynomial of degree capital D in d dimensions, the number of connected components of the complement of its zero set is order of degree to the dimension. So it's roughly t. So the parameters are correct. The proof uses a polynomial ham sandwich cut. I will not go into it. Just an illustration. So you have points in the plane. The blue curves is the zero set of a polynomial. And each connected component in this picture carefully drafted has at most 2 points. Of course, some points lie on the zero set, and the theorem doesn't say anything about what happens to them, how many of them, and so on. It is quite conceivable that all the points lie on the zero set. And then we are not in trouble, then we have to do something. So the first statement here is just a restatement of the result of Guth and Katz. I just drop the parameter d, t, and only talk about the degree. So if the degree is d, if you allow me degree d, then I can find such a polynomial of degree at most d. It partitions space into d to the d connected components, and each component will contain at most n over d to the d points of your input. Later, Larry Guth extended it so the input is no longer points but higher dimensional varieties. Just think of it as lines in three dimensions. Then you can again find the polynomial and partition space and so on, but now every connected component will be crossed by at most what's written there. For lines, it would be n over d square. If you do some calculation, you see that on average, this is always the case, but ensuring that it happens at every connected component is non-trivial and quite difficult proof, but we have that too. So again, polynomial components, and each is crossed by only a small number of lines, hopefully. And that gives you this polynomial partitioning technique. To people in computational combinatorial geometry, there were other techniques that were very successful, had nothing to do with algebra, but had limitations on their power, and this new technique supplements them very well, very successfully. Let me just indicate very quickly how one proves the Guth and Katz bound. We have m points and n lines in three dimensions. How many incidences can they have? So take the polynomial from the polynomial partitioning, call it f, excuse me, of some degree d, we'll choose d later. Obtain d cube connected components of the complement, each containing m over d cube points from the first result of Guth and Katz, and is crossed by at most n over d square lines from the second result of Guth. And now in each cell, there is a trivial incidence bound. If I give you m points and n lines, how many incidences can I get? At most m square plus n. Because if I, here is a point, here is a line passing through it. If no other point lies on the line, then the line has just one incidence, that's n. And if there is another point on the line, I charge the incidence to that other point. So every pair of points pay for an incidence. And there are roughly m square pairs, and that's how you get the incidence. It's a kind of a trivial argument. Just substitute the bounds on number of points, number of lines in each cell. So number of points square, number of lines, multiplied by the number of cells, and you get this quantity. So you just need to balance d here, and that turns out to be the right value. And if you substitute it here or here, you get the leading term in the Guth-Katz bound. So that looks like a trivial thing, but in fact, it's just the easy part of the argument, a very important a part, because without the polynomial partitioning, you couldn't do even that. But the question is, to quote Shakespeare, here lies the point. And the question is, what happens for the points that lie on the zero set? We know nothing about their number. We know nothing about them. We have to analyze them separately, and that's kind of the interesting part of the analysis. Because now you have points on a two-dimensional variety of a certain degree in three dimensions, and you have lines. It's easy to see that if the line crosses the zero set and not being fully contained in it, it contributes few incidences. We can control it. So the interesting situation is that you have points and lines that all lie on the zero set of the polynomial. How many incidences can we get? And it all boils down to the following question in algebraic geometry. Can an algebraic surface of degree D contain many lines? And the answer is that in general, no. It can contain many lines only if it's a ruled surface. Surface ruled by lines. This is one of the classical examples. It's actually a doubly ruled. There are two lines through each point here. This is the hyperboloid of one sheet, and there is also the hyperbolic paraboloid, z equal xy. But if the surface is not ruled, then it can contain at most roughly d square lines. That's a result from the 19th century by Cayley and Salmon, and earlier by Monge. And that's one of the basic ingredients that is used here. So now we have points and lines on the zero set. What do we do with them? So if the zero set is not ruled, then it cannot contain too many lines, and some induction or some other arguments will get rid of it. If it is ruled, then what happened is that the lines that generate the surface generally do not meet one another. So you get very few incidences. If they meet one another, they have to meet on the singular locus of the surface. And then it's again easy because somehow the points now lie on a one-dimensional curve. But it could also happen that the zero set contains planes. F has linear factors. And in this case, there are no three-dimensional tricks left. You really have to use the semi-reddit-rotor planar bound in order to get the bound here. And you do. But what saves you is this assumption that no plane contains too many lines. And when you use that assumption, which by the way holds in the Elikesh reduction, you get the bound. Okay. Let me kind of skip these commercial slides, but let me just say that the situation is really that many of the problems that by now have been completely or significantly solved were considered hopeless before this revolution, kind of what I call not in our lifetime. There was no hope that anybody could do anything with them, but now they are become, I don't want to say trivial, but they can be solved and have been solved. I gave a version of this talk last year in Paris, and I was looking for some French connection, and I found this, that when you end a fairy tale in French, it is customary to say, not they lived happily ever after, but they lived happily and had lots of children. So I want to think about this story as a fairy tale. I want to think that it has not ended yet, but there are many children. And I'll put a few slides to show you all the children. There is no time for me to go into them. But hopefully the talk can be found later. I will talk about a couple of the results that lie on those slides. But you can see that it has been used for quite a lot of fairly sophisticated problems. I will talk about the distinct distances between two lines. A few other things here. I will talk about this polynomial vanishing on grids, as you will see in a minute. And I will talk about depth cycles for lines in three dimensions, if I don't run out of time earlier, which most likely I will. But so I just chose a few of the items that you can see the method, or you can see the algebra, or you can see something anyway, or maybe not. So distinct distances between two lines. So this is a special case of the distinct distance problem. You have in the plane two lines, L1, L2. On each of them, you sprinkle n points, get sets P1, P2, and you now look at the number of distances between points on one line and points on the other line. So it's kind of bichromatic version of the problem. And you can show that this number is at least n to the 4/3, much better than the distinct distances bound of Erdős, because it's a special case, but you need to assume that the lines are non-parallel and non-orthogonal. Because it's a situation of this form. Because if the lines are parallel or orthogonal, it's very easy to construct sets with only a linear number of distinct distances. Either take two arithmetic progressions on the line or take points at square root distances from the origin if the lines are orthogonal. So if the lines are not orthogonal and not parallel, it was conjectured that the bound should be superlinear, and Elikesh, of course, managed to prove it and actually get a significantly superlinear bound later. And in a work with Sheffer and Shoimoshi, we got this n to the 4/3 lower bound. We used a very ad hoc technique of reducing the question to incidences, same as the Guth-Katz approach, Elikesh approach, to points and hyperbolas in the plane. The proof is very easy, but I want to complicate it by relating it to a more general result about this, again, work by Elekesh, Ronai, and Sabo that we later managed to simplify and improve. And the question, which I think is an interesting question in itself, goes as follows. I give you three sets of n real numbers each, and I look at their Cartesian product, A times B times C, and I have a trivariate polynomial F. Let's say it's over the reals, although that extends to the complex case too. And I ask a simple question, how many zeros can F have on this Cartesian product? And for concreteness, let's focus on the simple case where F is just of the form Z minus Fxy, so it's like a graph of a bivariate polynomial. And then, of course, an upper bound is n squared, because for every value of x in A and y in B, I get at most one value in C. And in fact, you can get this bound. For example, if A and B and C are just the integers 1 through n and the polynomial is the sum, or if the A, B, and C are powers of 2 and the polynomial is the product. But what's amazing is that these are the only two possibilities. So what Elekesh and Ronai proved in 2000 was that these are the only two possibilities, or more generally, because you can always change variables, if you can get quadratically many zeros on the Cartesian product, then F must be of one of these two special forms. It's the sum or the product with some change of variables. And everything here is a polynomial, which is even more amazing. But as we have shown later, if F does not have the special form, then the number of zeros is at most n to the 11.6. So it's either quadratic special form or at most n to the 11.6 not special form. What's the connection? Why is this a generalization of the distinct distance question on two lines? Because here is the polynomial. We need three sets and we need the polynomial. The polynomial is simply the distance or the squared distance between a point here and a point here. So we use x to parameterize the point here, y to parameterize the point here, and the square distance by the law of cosines is just that. So P1 and P2 will be A and B, and C will be the set of values that we can get. These are now not of the same size. This is an unbalanced version of the problem, but we can handle that. In fact, we start by knowing what the answer is. The answer is n squared, because every point in P1, every point in P2 determine a distance between them that is one of the values in C. Now, does F have the special form? So it's interesting that this is exactly what the question assumes. It has the special form when the lines are parallel or orthogonal. That's very easy to see. And it doesn't have the special form when the lines are not parallel and not orthogonal. Again, not too difficult to see. It's only a bivariate, a quadratic polynomial here. What have I done? So we need an unbalanced version of the problem. And the actual bound is that. If I give you the three sets A, B, and C, the bound is slightly more involved, but essentially it looks like that. That's how you get the 11.6. If they all are equal to n. 4/3 plus 1/2 is 11.6. But in our case, it will be n to the 4/3 here and here, and c to the 1/2. But we know that it is n squared. And if we solve this inequality, we get that c is n to the 4/3. So the moral of it is that this Elekesh, Ronai, and later Sabo, which is more complicated because it deals with arbitrary polynomials, trivariate polynomials, is a powerful technique that lets you solve many problems. And there are many problems that, not too many, but quite a few that have been solved using this technique. And I should say that the only, quote unquote, open issue here is to argue that F does not have the special form. or sometimes to realize that it does have the special form. That's not completely easy if the polynomial is quite complicated. There are techniques. The techniques are very difficult to carry out. But let me skip to the next and final topic. How much time do I still have? 20. Oh, plenty. So I'm speaking too fast, I'm afraid. All right. All right, so the last topic I want to mention is the following question. It's kind of breaking or eliminating cycles in a collection of lines and triangles or curves or whatever in three dimensions. What am I talking about? So suppose I have a set of n lines in three dimensions, and suppose that they are in general position, whatever that means. Do not touch each other, are not parallel to one another, and so on. and then for any pair of lines, there is a unique vertical line that passes through both of them. And I will say that L1 lies below L2 if that line meets L1 at a point that lies below where it meets L2. Kind of the obvious thing. L1 lies below L2 because when it passes below it, it passes below it and not above it. So this is a total relationship. Every pair of lines, by general position assumption, are related to one another. But this is not necessarily an order, because it can have cycles. And this is a very simple example of a cycle. And you can have more complicated ones. So I'm looking at it from above, from below, doesn't matter. But in every line passes above the next one. The red passes above the blue passes above the yellow, and the yellow passes above the red. And this is, quote unquote, bad. And I would like to turn the configuration into one that has a depth order, where the relation is acyclic. And how do I do that? By taking the lines and breaking them, cutting them at various points, so that now I don't have lines anymore. I have segments and rays and maybe some lines that I didn't cut. And so now the relation is no longer total because not every pair of objects now pass below one another, but the relation is now acyclic. That's what I need. And this problem turned out to be also one of those extremely difficult problems that basically no progress and no solution was achieved for many years, 35 years. And there were some partial results under some assumptions, but the real problem was never, there was nothing. Well, let me kind of be specific. What do I mean by nothing? There is always a trivial way to eliminate all the cycles by cutting every pair of lines at the points where they lie vertically above each other. Because then there are there is no relation anymore. There are no, nothing passes above the other anymore if I remove the points away. But that will require a quadratic number of cuts. The goal is to show that you can eliminate all cycles by fewer than quadratically many cuts. And the problem has some motivation from computer graphics, which probably does not exist anymore, but it used to be a major issue before in this hidden surface removal or rendering problem in computer graphics. So instead of lines, let's say we have triangles, and the triangles are pairwise disjoint. And a cycle, we can still have a cycle among the triangles. And the triangles actually model a scene with our objects that we model as kind of a mesh of triangles. And we would like to draw the scene in such a way that we see only the visible parts of it. So there is this painter's algorithm that paints the objects or the triangles one by one in back to front order. So it it paints on the screen the farthest triangle, then the next one, then the next one, then the next one. Everyone that is painted hides, is paints over what's already on the screen, and that way you get a perfect, the correct view, provided that there are no cycles. Because if there are cycles, there is no way that you can draw these three triangles one after the other and get the picture that we see here. So that was the main motivation, and it's strongly related to the joins problem because, and so everything is in the same boat, because we can take a joint, side view of it, and perturb, I mean, kind of move the lines slightly parallel to themselves in such a way that this joint will become a small triangular cycle. And if I want to eliminate all those cycles, I have to make at least one cut at each joint. Because if I don't cut those lines around this area, the cycle will remain. So the number of joints is like a lower bound for the number of cuts that I need. And since we know that the number of joints is at most n to the 3 half, so we should be prepared to pay at least n to the 3 half cuts to the cycle elimination problem. And using this algebraic machinery, we were able to almost obtain this bound. We got n to the 3 half times the polylogarithmic factor. And the same thing works if you have line segments, and even if you have, instead of lines, you have constant degree algebraic curves. And the proof actually is easy, and I want to show it to you. It uses polynomial partitioning, and it's kind of interesting because there are no incidences here anymore. There are no points, there are only lines. They do not touch each other, and yet the polynomial partition helps effectively. So again, I want to use the advanced result of Guth, the second result, that doesn't have points as input, but lines, say, in three dimensions. And that's exactly what I said before. So if we have lines, n lines, and some degree d, we can find the polynomial of degree d, partition space into d cube cells, and each cell is crossed by at most n over d square lines. That's what I want to use. So I construct such a polynomial, and I look at the result. Now, each cycle I can represent geometrically as a closed loop where I walk along the line, I go up to the next line, I walk along that line, I go up, I walk along the other line, go up, until I get back to the point where I started. So I can represent each cycle by a closed polygonal loop in space. And it's very easy to see that if I want to eliminate the cycle, I must make sure that each one of these loops is being cut, but not cut on a vertical jump because that's useless, cut along one of the segments on the lines. So if I cut the blue line somewhere between those two points, the cycle is eliminated. So we've constructed this zero set, and now we look at one such cycle, geometrically represented cycle, pi of c. So the simplest case is that the zero set doesn't cut that curve at all, which means that the curve is passed completely into a subproblem in one of the cells of the partition. And I will handle it recursively or inductively or whatever. Or the curve may be cut by the zero set. So there is a good situation, a bad situation. The good situation is that that the zero set simply cuts one of the lines of the curve, which is exactly what we want. Now, a line intersect, it will appear on a further slide, a line can intersect the zero set of a polynomial of degree d in at most d points. So we draw those points on the lines, and the cycle is eliminated. But there is a possibility that the zero set intersect this curve at a vertical jump, like here. So I didn't eliminate the cycle at all. So what do I do? Now, In this case, however, something happens. What happens is that the level of this curve, with respect to the zero set has gone up by at least one. What is the level? If you give me a point, I simply look down and ask how many times do I intersect the zero set? And that's my level, ignoring the degenerate situation where I intersect it kind of at a double root or whatever. That's kind of a well-defined notion under certain assumptions. So if this happens, the level at the yellow is at least one larger than the level at the blue. But this is a closed curve. If I go around it and get back to my starting point, the level did not change. So whatever goes up must come down. How can it come down? Well, the nice thing about it is that it cannot come down by at another intersection with the vertical jump, because all the vertical jumps go up. This is why it's a cycle. So if I want the level to go down, I must intersect the zero set again, not at a vertical jump, or something else must happen. So what can happen? There are two ways. Either I do intersect the zero set on one of the lines, or the level changes abruptly. Something happens that the level drops down without meeting the lines themselves. How can that happen? So this is the case where I intersect one of the lines, but this is exactly what I want, because then the cycle is eliminated for sure. Or I can pass above a point of a vertical tangency of the zero set. And then the level goes from 2 to 0, drops, which will fix the increase here. But again, there are not too many places where that can happen, because on the vertical screen below the blue line, the planar vertical screen, I get a bivariate polynomial that can have, of degree d, that can have at most roughly d square points of vertical tangency or other singularity of that sort, which follows from a bunch of classical theorems, Harnack, Bezout, whatever. So what I do, I simply take each one of those singularities and go up vertically and cut the line here. So, and again, the cycle is eliminated. So altogether, I made n d square cuts. There were d cuts before, but just when the zero set crosses the lines, and there are d square new cuts for each at each line because of this vertical screen consideration. So altogether, I have nd square cuts plus what I need to do recursively in the cells. So I get this recurrence. There are d cube cells, and in each one of them, there are only n over d square lines. That's Guth's partition polynomial. And I pay this nd square non-recursively. And if I solve this recurrence with a suitable choice of D, I get n to the 3 half, roughly. So that's it. I should wind down, but let me just say that this opened up several other developments. And they are interesting in their own right. I could have shown them to you, but let me just say that one of them solves another open interesting problem, that I have a set of points, I have a set of curves, simple curves in the plane, say circles or more complicated curves, and I want to cut them into arcs so that the arcs will be pseudo segments. No pair of arcs should intersect more than once. We knew how to do it for circles, but this method, which I will not explain, gives you a general way of doing it. You can always cut such arcs into n to the 3 half, roughly n to the 3 half points, and the final pieces, the resulting pieces are pseudo segments. Okay, and there are some other conclusions and stories which I really want to skip. It leads to very strange incidence bounds between points and curves under certain assumptions. Never mind that. And let me just kind of stop here. Just to reiterate, it's kind of a new technology, or actually it's not a single technology. The polynomial partitioning is an ingredient, but the analysis of Elekesh, Rona, and Sabo uses algebra in a different context. But it seems that using algebraic techniques is very effective for problems in combinatorial geometry. And, and again, the Erdős distinguishes problem, the success in solving it is a major kind of positive indication that this is okay. The question in higher dimensions, in three dimensions, this distance in three dimensions is still open, because when you apply Elekesh tricks to it, you get into issues of incidences between points and higher dimensional object in higher dimensional space, and that becomes, that is too difficult yet for us to solve. But anyway, that's the end of my story, and thank you very much for your attention. It's a very good question. Again, it's supposed to be new developments in combinatorial and computational geometry, but most of the results are in combinatorial geometry, and the construction is the difficult part, because if you want to find such a polynomial, kind of the real polynomial, so to speak, you need to find a ham sandwich cut in very high dimension. And that's a problem. I mean, again, the Borsuk-Ulam theorem guarantees that it exists and so on, but computing it is very inefficient. I mean, if you want to spend exponential time, you can, but if you want to do it efficiently, you can. So there is essentially one paper that shows how to compute an approximate partitioning polynomial using a randomized efficient technique, but and there is now in the works another such algorithm that does it more along the lines of Guth partitioning polynomial and so on. There are nice techniques there, but I admit that these new developments are rather weak on the algorithmic side. And the bottleneck is, as you said, how to compute such partitioning polynomials efficiently. Some results are known, but very little. In which problem? No, no, I didn't say that we want to avoid them. I said that we need to handle them, to analyze them specially. Yes, this is really where the algebraic geometry plays the major part in this Guth, Katz, et cetera, development. In many, yeah, I mean, sort of once you, in basically all the incidence problems that you're trying to solve, there is always a routine part where you handle what happens outside the zero set in the cells. That's more or less, you have the machinery to do it. And then what happens on the zero set. This is still far from being fully resolved. We know how to do it in three dimensions in certain cases, but that's really where the algebra has to work hardest, and it's no longer this polynomial partition business, although people have tried to solve this problem by finding a second partitioning polynomial that only partitions the points that lie on the surface, on the zero set, And there are some successes there. But that's where the challenge is. I'm not sure that that answered your question, but OK. Maybe I should also only say that this polynomial partitioning works mainly over the reals. It is not an effective tool for finite fields or even the complex fields because you need inequalities there. And so there are many of the techniques that have been extended to the complex case and some also to finite fields, but polynomial partitioning is inherently a real or real closed or whatever setup. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah. No further questions. And thanks again.
Thank you.